Good afternoon. I'm Peter Bergen. I welcome to the New America Foundation on this not very nice day. Thank you for coming out. I run the Fellows Program here. It's my pleasure to introduce my friend and our colleague, Shane Harris, who's been a fellow at New America for quite some time. And during the fellowship, he wrote this brilliant book, At War, The Rise of the Military Internet Complex, which I think is going to be really the definitive book for both the lay audience and an expert audience about cyber warfare. Shane has been a senior writer at Foreign Policy for quite some time. He's just moved over to the Daily Beast. He had another book, The Watchers, which was also very well reviewed. So he's going to talk about some of the big themes and stories in his book, and then we'll open it up to a question and answer.
Sounds good. Okay. Thank you all for coming. It is a mucky day out there, so I'm glad we're inside and hopefully you're comfortable and cozy. Let me start just by saying, by the way, thank you very much to New America. As Peter said, I've been a fellow here for a while now, and this was the project that brought me here. And it's just been a tremendous community of fellows and people not only in the national security space, but doing all sorts of other tremendous work, which has been really stimulating and gratifying. So this was a great sort of a second home for me as I was doing the research and writing the book. So thank you all. So basically this story, and it is a story, the book is very much written in narrative fashion, which I think tends to be the better way of communicating complex and abstract ideas than trying to write a tech book, is really about how cybersecurity became the central kind of preoccupation and the big priority right now for national security in the United States. And what I mean by cybersecurity is we're talking about defending computer systems and computer networks, both from people who are trying to steal information from our government, our military and intelligence agencies, but also American corporations, trying to defend the critical infrastructure that is attached and run to our networks and run increasingly on the internet, including pieces of our power grid, our utilities, our financial sector, our air traffic control system, transportation communication systems, healthcare increasingly is becoming networked. But also how the military and the intelligence community in this country, in cooperation with large companies in the tech sector, are turning to offensive operations in cyberspace. How are we doing many of the things to other countries and groups that we fear are being done to us? And it's kind of that alliance between these military and intelligence agencies and the tech sector, to include your ISPs, your telecom companies, and even some big marquee companies, commercial technology companies, that I call the military internet complex. Just to give you some sort of perspective how Washington sees the cyber threat right now, the landscape of threats out there, to include hackers in China, Russia, state-sponsored, North Korea, Iran, which has been up in the news again as of this morning for launching another a malware attack in the U.S. Cybersecurity and cyber threats have topped the intelligence community's list of global threats for the past 2 years. This is an annual report that all of the intelligence agencies put out saying basically what are the things that are keeping us up at night. For the past 2 years, cyber's been at the top. Jim Comey, who's the new FBI director and was previously deputy attorney general, has said the risk of cyber attacks and a rise in cyber-related crime, including espionage and financial fraud, will be the most significant national security threat over the next decade. We've been living in a decade of terrorism as being the big threat, and now cyber seems to be sort of, you know, edging alongside of it, if not pushing it off the ledger a bit. So how did we get to this point where protecting computer networks has become sort of a central focus and a top priority for our national security policymakers, including up to the president himself? I'll kind of tell a story about where this all begins, and it's what kind of sets off the book as well and gives you an insight into how this military internet complex first emerged. This is in the summer of 2007, and the CEOs of the country's biggest defense contracting firms, your Raytheons, Lockheed Martins, Boeings, Northrop Grumman, are brought to a meeting at the Pentagon. They're not exactly sure why they're there, but if you're looking around a room of your competitors, you probably think it's not good news that's brought you to the Pentagon on short notice. They are brought inside a secure facility known as a SCIF, which is built to be impervious to eavesdropping. If you watch Homeland or spy movies, this is the place where you have to drop your cell phone before you go in and shed all of your electronic gear. So they're taken inside this room and they're given a what's billed as a threat briefing. And military officials show them how hackers, presumably spies in China working for the government, have penetrated the computer systems of these companies' networks and are stealing now information on the programs that they are working on for the Pentagon, and particularly in one called the Joint Strike Fighter, which is a next-generation stealth fighter jet. It's the single most expensive weapons program the Pentagon has ever managed. These spies are getting into the company's networks, sort of making an end run around the military systems rather than trying to break into the Pentagon or the armed forces directly, going to these companies, which, come to find out, were not very well protected. The CEOs are learning at this point for the first time just how weak their network security is and what the tangible consequences of that are. This information is being stolen. As it was explained to somebody who was at the meeting, told me a lot of these CEOs went in with dark hair, and when they came out, it had turned white. They were very, very nervous to find out how vulnerable they were, and of course, realizing the repercussions of this could be that they could potentially lose business. The Pentagon says to them, basically, you have a security problem, therefore we have a security problem, and if we're going to continue working together, you are going to make some changes. And what emerges out of this is something that's called the Defense Industrial Base Initiative, or the DIB for short, a little bureaucratic lingo. We like acronyms in Washington. But what this really is a partnership whereby the Pentagon says, we are going to start providing you companies who are working for us with classified intelligence that we have been getting and gathering about hackers, about the people who are breaking into your networks, about the people who are threatening our networks, essentially giving you the fruits of espionage. We're going to hand that over to you so you can better protect your systems. And in return, you are going to tell us what you are seeing on your many networks around the world. This is important because the government does not own computer networks in this country, at least not many of them. About 85% of our infrastructure that makes up the internet is privately owned. So the government absolutely needs corporations to help them. And you see this developing in microcosm right here, where these dozen or so companies, it's now about 100, enter into this information and intelligence sharing partnership with the government and the intelligence community for the purposes of protecting networks. That essential model that's born in 2007 now is sort of the way that the government works with private industry in this country to protect computer systems. Now the NSA, in principle, gives threat information about hackers to internet service providers, the telecommunications companies that are running the backbone of the internet, in the hopes that they will program that information into their filters and kind of protect people downstream. We know that the NSA has entered into a partnership, the contours of which are still secret, with Google, one of the biggest commercial technology companies in the world, and Google provides the NSA with information about threats that it's seeing against its networks. The government wants that because Google is effectively a big global sentry when you think about it, and Google might want the help of the NSA to find out who in China is trying to steal their intellectual property and their secrets and violate the security of their customers. So this arrangement takes off really at the end of the Bush administration, or begins, I should say, at the end of the Bush administration, but it really starts to gain momentum during the beginning of the Obama administration. And I think that's a really important understanding of how this pivots, because President Obama came in as really the most technologically savvy president that I think we have ever had.
He had a BlackBerry.
He had a BlackBerry, absolutely. And he starts, and he gets his, and he didn't want to give it up either. So the NSA built him a special one. He gets his daily briefings on an iPad. I mean, he's a very tech-savvy president. George Bush before him famously once said he used the Google to look at pictures of his ranch in Texas. Not to pick on him, but Bill Clinton purportedly sent one email in his entire time as president. Granted, the internet was still fairly new and people were using AOL and the like. But you have in Obama someone who comes in who gets technology. He is of technology. He is the internet president. His campaign email was actually hacked presumably by Chinese spies while he was running for office, as was John McCain's, by the way. So he comes in understanding that the internet is something that is vulnerable, that is being exploited by our adversaries, and that also, frankly, is a space that we need to be operating in as well. He adds a whole new dimension to the sort of the beginnings of the priorities that Bush gave to protecting our defense industrial base. Obama decides there needs to be a big national strategy for cybersecurity. And in May 2009, he gives a speech in the East Room of the White House, which is always a big event when it's in the East Room because that's where the really momentous policy speeches are. And he stands up and he gives this extraordinary admission where he says that foreign organizations, he does not say who, have penetrated the computer systems that control the electrical power grid in the United States. Up until that point, that had been largely rumor. And intelligence officials would talk to people like me and say these things very off the record. This was now the President of the United States getting up and saying, yes, our electrical grid has, to an extent, been penetrated by hackers who could conceivably turn the lights off in major cities and send whole cities into darkness, in his words. He says that the United States policy is going to be to work with the private sector, the owners of critical infrastructure, that they will collaborate with industry to find solutions that, quote, ensure our security and promote prosperity. The internet is a strategic national asset, Obama said, and we intend to protect it as such. So here you have the President of the United States laying out the national policy of this thing we call cyberspace, this sort of abstraction, if you know, in a way, and putting real tangible definition on it, saying this is a place where we depend upon our vital commercial systems to function properly, our critical infrastructure to function properly, and it is vulnerable and we are going to protect it. So Obama is essentially defining cyberspace, really how the military has come to look at it, I think, as well. Military now calls cyberspace the fifth domain of warfare, after air, land, sea, and outer space, and views trying to achieve supremacy there as vital as it is in the other four. You can always sort of follow the money in Washington, I think, if you want to get an idea of where the priorities are being placed. And right now, if you unpack the defense budget looking at cybersecurity specifically, both the defensive and, you know, the offensive components too, you see where these priorities are. Just to give you a couple of data points, in 2014, the government planned to spend $13 billion just on cyber defense programs and information sharing with private industry, the kind that I've been describing. That's $13 billion on cyber defense in 2014. In the same year, there is $11.6 billion allocated for direct efforts to combat climate change, which Obama has called the global threat of our time, his words. So $13 billion in cyber, $11.6 billion in climate change. The 2012 Pentagon budget had the word cyber in it 12 times. The 2014 Pentagon budget has it 147 times. It's become kind of a joke now, I think, in defense circles that if you want funding for a new project, you just slap the word cyber onto it and the money will come. It's really the only part of the budget that's not being slashed. In fact, a senior DOD cybersecurity official about a month ago was giving a speech where he joked that he's seeing a lot of requests coming across his desk for things like the cyber tank, which is not a real thing, obviously. But that gives you some measure, I think, of into how cyber has become now the way that we even talk about national security. It's all related to cyber somehow. And in that context, government officials have become much more public and vocal about talking about all the ways that we are vulnerable. I mean, Obama kind of kicked it off by coming out and saying, my email got hacked, the power grid's at risk. And there's really been a flood of officials coming forward after that to talk about all the ways that we are at risk. What that tends to mask, though, is all of the ways that we, in fact, are one of the biggest aggressors in cyberspace. I talked about the military treating cyberspace as a battlefield. That is an offensive dynamic. And I try and get at many stories in the book, in the first half of the book, that really talk about sort of how we are waging war in cyberspace. And I'll tell you one that I think sets the stage for how the military and the NSA, in particular, our largest intelligence agency, which really is the center of gravity for our cyber efforts, kind of came to view cyberspace as a battlefield and how it's informing the way that we're going to fight wars in the future. So this is also in 2007. A lot happens in 2007 in this book. At the time of the troop surge in Iraq, President Bush ordered tens of thousands of additional ground forces in Iraq to quell the insurgency that was spiraling there and threatening to plunge the whole country into civil war. A lot has been written about the role of that combat troop surge in quelling the violence and in ultimately achieving what turned out to be a temporary victory against al-Qaeda in Iraq. Less is known, though, about the cyber component of this. Commensurate with the troops going in, the NSA taps into and essentially takes over the entire communication systems of the country of Iraq. The agency developed the ability to intercept every phone call, every email, and every text message that was sent in the country. This is an absolutely extraordinary technological feat that they did. The purpose of this was to gather information about insurgents and ultimately to try and physically locate where they were. So I read about one guy in the book, a man named Bob Stasio, who was a young lieutenant in the Army. He was a big fan of the HBO show The Wire, which I don't know if any of you have seen this or not, but there's a detective in The Wire named Lester Freeman who, rather than trying to go out and gather human intelligence on who the drug runners are and the kingpins in Baltimore that are sort of, you know, these street gangs, he starts monitoring their cell phones and looking for all the calling patterns of who's calling who, how long they're talking, and tries to develop a network of who these people are based on their metadata, this word that we have now become more familiar with post-Snowden. The NSA does this in Iraq and does it to great effect and are able to actually physically locate people and understand the structures of suicide bombing networks and insurgent networks based on their communications patterns. And they do more as well, other daring exploits that I write about. At one point they were sending fake text messages to insurgent fighters to lure them into traps, posing as people they knew. The NSA and its hackers were able to get into jihadi web forums and chat rooms and load them up with spyware so that when people visited them, essentially beacons were placed on their computer that showed where they were physically sitting on a network if they hadn't taken steps to shield that their location. This information is then handed off to ground troops who follow up on it and go find these people and capture or kill them. In most cases, actually capture, is what I was told. It resulted more in arrests than it often resulted in deaths. The people I interviewed for the book will credit this intelligence program, this cyber operation, as being the linchpin that turned the tide of the war. Had we not had this intelligence gathering effort to then give information to the ground forces, they would not have been able to follow up and disrupt those networks and pull them apart. David Petraeus actually has publicly talked about this, and I think a comment that wasn't widely credited at the time. He said that this intelligence-driven warfare enabled the removal of almost 4,000 insurgents from the battlefield. That's a really extraordinary victory. And this informed the way that the NSA goes about now intelligence gathering and operating in cyberspace with the military in that fifth domain. And I think it's going to change the way that wars are fought in the future. So let me just wrap this up a bit, and then we'll have discussion by saying, you know, why does this matter to any of us? You know, why does it matter that the fifth domain of warfare is now in cyberspace, that the NSA is increasing surveillance as part of that? I think that actually, in its zeal to sort of conquer this battle space, the military is making the internet less safe for all of us. There are two examples I'll point to in particular. One is the NSA's efforts to undermine a lot of the technology that we all depend upon every day to protect our communications and to keep us safe on the internet. You may be familiar with something called encryption. Encryption is a way that you can shield the messages that you are sending to someone else so they can't be read, but it's also how your bank makes sure that your financial transactions are secure and that vital information about you cannot be intercepted and misused. The NSA has been known as part of its efforts to prepare the cyber battlefield to be trying to undermine encryption standards. Why would they be doing that? Well, the NSA wants to be able to read communications and be able to gain access to technology used around the world as part of its offensive cyber mission, both for spying and for more of the military kind of activities I talked about. To do that, it needs to be able to have privileged access to the technology that we all use and wants to make sure that it understands its weaknesses in ways that other people don't. So a number of years ago, the NSA was involved in writing an encryption algorithm that it actually then publicly encouraged people and companies to adopt, knowing that there was a flaw in it that it had helped devise but never advertised. This would be a bit like the government coming out and saying to all homeowners, buy the following brand of door lock. It will keep all of the burglars out and keep you safe, but the government secretly has a key for the lock. And oh, by the way, it's not very well hidden. Somebody else could find it too. The NSA has also been looking for flaws in commercial technology known as zero-day vulnerabilities. These are basically holes in computer programs and in operating systems that have never been discovered except by an individual hacker or a researcher who, if he were to exploit that vulnerability, there would be 0 days to defend against it. The agency actually buys these vulnerabilities and this information from hackers on a black market and hoards them in order to have this kind of privileged hidden access to technology that we're all using every day and it's being used around the world. NSA is known to be the single largest acquirer of this information and is really fueling a market that is based in trying to find the fundamental weaknesses in commercial technology. There's an inherent conflict inside an agency that on the one hand is dedicated to trying to protect our vital networks and our critical infrastructure, and at the other hand, as part of its offensive mission, is trying to undermine the security of the systems that run those networks. And that's something that I think that is really the big nettlesome kind of policy challenge that the book presents. I don't have an easy answer for that, but I think that this is sort of where the book leaves us, is saying that we are now living in this era where the government is treating the internet as a vital asset, it is trying to protect it, but it is also taking these extraordinary measures to operate offensively in it, and we risk sort of being collateral damage in that as well.
Thank you very much, Shane. I mean, there's another sort of, it's almost unexamined, the issue that NSA is, after all, a Pentagon intelligence agency, which is doing a lot of intelligence collection in the United States.
Right, absolutely. And I mean, we now know much more about this thanks to Edward Snowden.
Yeah.
And others of us were writing about this beforehand. It seems like there's a mismatch there, where you have a military agency conducting domestic intelligence gathering.
Right, which was designed to fight the Soviets, but now it's
absolutely,
sort of essentially in the domestic spying game.
Right, and it's been ever since the demise of the Soviet Union sort of went looking for a mission, and cybersecurity and cyber warfare sort of presented itself as one, as did 9/11 create the need for terrorism surveillance. I find it very problematic that we have an intelligence agency in the business of some kind of national sort of civic defense. Right now we have...
Well, should it be the Department of Homeland Security? I mean, they're trying to get into that space a bit, but they don't have the computer geeks, in a sense,
right,
that NSA has, right?
So. And nominally it is the Homeland Security Department.
Yeah.
So officially, on the books, DHS is what's known as the interface to the private sector and to state and local governments. In reality, the guts of the operation are within the NSA. And complicating matters even more, the director of the National Security Agency is also the commander of something called U.S. Cyber Command, which is nominally the military's combatant command for cyber warfare, which is a good thing that we have that, because cyber is going to be a part of how we fight wars. We should start thinking about how we're going to organize that. But you have the head of an intelligence agency running a military operation and serving in two positions at one time. So it's another way that they've...
There was some discussion of making that a two different people, right?
Right.
And that the Obama administration flirted with that idea and it didn't happen. Why?
I think it didn't happen because they view that as too disruptive right now, and because they believe that the NSA is where all of the best hackers are, and they're right.
Mm.
So if you suddenly decide tomorrow, well, okay, Cyber Command, you're it now, and the 300 or whatever people who were actually working there and have not filled all their billets say, well, what do we do? Where do we turn for the expertise to actually run this mission? Well, it resides largely at the NSA. So I think that, it may be that this kind of dual hatting only lasts through the tenure of the current NSA director. In fact, Michael Hayden, the ex-director of the NSA, has said that the two should not be joined together. But I think that was a step that the administration was frankly not willing to take. And if you look at the other recommendations that were made post-Snowden about ways to reform surveillance and other cyber operations, the administration rejected almost all of them.
So how glad were you about the Snowden revelations? I mean, how far into the book were you? I mean, do the thought experiment where those revelations happened after you'd finished the book.
Right.
Would that have been a problem?
It would have been, I think. I mean, there was a lot revealed in the Snowden documents about our offensive cyber operations that, frankly, has not gotten a lot of play. I mean, we've tended to focus more on the surveillance aspects for terrorism and less the way that the government is organizing to do offensive cyber. There is a lot of really rich detailed information in there, and a lot of things that were able to then point me to people to be able to ask them questions about. There are acronyms and names that are not widely known in those documents that allow you to then start a conversation with sources that makes it more productive. I was probably about 4 months into researching the book. I think it was maybe 4 or 5 months after we'd signed the contract when the documents came out, so it was very good timing.
You've written about, these are hard subjects to get people to talk about. You and James Bamford are probably two of the leading people to get inside the NSA. tell us a little bit about your reporting process to the extent that you can.
Yeah. I started out writing about technology in around January of 2001. I was a young reporter assigned to write about information technology and procurement. Which is a very, very sexy beat for a budding 25-year-old reporter. And what that gave me actually was entree into the world of contractors, actually, and people who were building technology systems for government, companies that are run by former military officers and senior officials. I mean, that revolving door, once people get out of government, they tend to be a lot chattier. This is before 9/11, and you know, it was an era when it was the post-dot-com era, and sort of tech and government was the new big thing. E-government was a buzzword. And I sort of got familiar with a lot of these people. And after 9/11, it was the tech space in government where a lot of the national security action started happening, because these companies who were in the business of trying to build, you know, data systems for government to better manage things like IRS tax returns and government payroll and logistics management suddenly realized, hey, we can build systems for counterterrorism. We can build systems to collect intelligence and share information between the FBI and the CIA and the NSA. This whole kind of national security world sort of invaded that tech space, and the two started mixing together. That is really how I became initiated into the world of, you know, cyber and surveillance and signals intelligence and electronic spying, which has really been kind of the center of gravity for a lot of my work. Over time, it's just a matter of getting to know those people and being extremely patient unfailingly pleasant and polite, and getting them to tell me their stories.
Is it Francis Drake? Did that case,
Tom Drake.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Did that case give you pause? I mean, explain a little bit about what the implications of that case are.
Yeah, that case gave me pause for a couple of reasons. One is that it reminded me how risky it has become to report on this subject. So Thomas Drake, for those who don't know, was a senior National Security Agency official who, I guess in around 2005 it would have been, got in touch with a reporter for the Baltimore Sun to reveal ways that the NSA was spending billions of dollars on technology programs that weren't working.
He was a classic whistleblower.
Classic whistleblower, and had tried to avail himself of many internal channels, had gotten nowhere, and ultimately, in my view, revealed wasteful spending. That is exactly what you want a whistleblower to do, and also pointed a light on some of the more aggressive surveillance operations and programs themselves, but really was trying to reveal waste, fraud, and abuse. The government came down on him like a ton of bricks, and ultimately he was vindicated. The judge ultimately, threw the case out, but not for after 2 years, I think it was, of basically being hounded by authorities. And what this really pointed out was that the government was going to go to great lengths to find people who talked to journalists and exposed secrets, even if they were doing it in the classic sort of whistleblower mode. It was at that point, really, I think, that a lot of journalists got, you know, more tuned in to the way that this administration in particular has been cracking down on leaks, and realized that we had to be just far more careful than we already probably were in protecting our sources, and recognizing that this was a domain where the government was not really going to tolerate a lot of leaking. Even if it was done in the mode of trying to, you know, protect the public interest by exposing billions of dollars in wasteful spending.
Yeah, we at the New America Foundation did a survey when the NSA claims about how successful they've been against terrorism came out. And we found that there was only one case, which is a case I can describe very briefly, which was a taxi driver in San Diego sent $7,000 to Al-Shabaab, the Somali terrorist group, in 2007, 2008. But that was the one case that NSA phone metadata produced. Mm-hmm. Let's sort of reflect a little bit on, I mean, this is a massive program, yeah. Which, with very thin pickings in terms of the actual results. Mm-hmm. And in fact, you know, almost all cases, terrorism cases in this country are, you know, typical law enforcement activity. Somebody drops a dime on you, you do something stupid, you get caught, whatever. I mean, these kinds of, it turned out that this was not really useful.
Yeah, that's right. And I mean, it, even when NSA was asked the question, point to cases that, you know, you can say that this metadata collection resulted in an attack being foiled. I mean, the number, I forget what it was first. It was
well, 54 was the first.
And then it got ratcheted down, and you know, and then eventually they had to back down from their other claims.
So they made a huge mistake, which is they went out and they made a completely indefensible claim right at the beginning.
Yeah, and I think that what this also illustrated is the extent to which after 9/11, much of our intelligence community has become dependent upon signals intelligence and cyber-related activities. And, you know, because it has been so difficult, as you know better than anyone, I think, to penetrate, you know, the inner human networks of Al-Qaeda, the experience in Iraq, frankly, showed how if you have the ability to monitor communications, it can be extremely powerful for locating people. And I think that the military and the intel agencies right now see technical surveillance, whether it be from cyber or from drones or satellites, which is something that people aren't talking a lot about much, but is hugely important in this. The ability to have persistent surveillance from space on one spot of the Earth. That is really driving how we conduct espionage and intelligence gathering and counterterrorism in the United States. So when NSA came out after the Snowden revelations and clung fiercely to this metadata program as being indispensable, it really didn't surprise me, because the whole community has now become situated around electronic intelligence gathering and operating in cyberspace as sort of being where we have the advantage.
You call it the military internet complex. I mean, reflect a little bit. We're here sitting in Washington, D.C. You know, on 9/11, one out of 10 of the richest counties in the United States were in the Washington area. Now seven out of 10 are. I mean, to what extent has this military internet complex, is there any sense of how large it is? Yeah. Who are the big players? Where are they?
I think in a lot of ways it mirrors, and I consciously draw an analogy to the military-industrial complex that President Eisenhower coined in his 1961 speech. I think I've learned this since writing the book, that he was originally going to call it the military-industrial congressional complex, but scratched the word congressional from the speech at the last minute because he didn't want to ruffle too many feathers. Yet to a great extent, it is the kind of classic defense contractors, Lockheed Martin, Boeing, Raytheon. These are companies that are not only providing the government with intelligence, but they're working on weapon systems. Many of them are working on cyber programs specifically. Raytheon is publicly a company that provides zero-day information to the NSA. It goes out and acquires it. So they're very much in the mix. But really what's also encompasses now are the big telecom companies. You know, we talked about the metadata program. That is a program in which the major phone carriers in the United States are handing over information to the NSA. But we also have the agency, via the Homeland Security Department, working with the ISPs now, providing internet service providers with cyber threat intelligence, trying to get them to tell them, what are you seeing on your networks as well? It really has encompassed the tech sector to include the companies who are running our communications networks that basically are the internet in many ways. That's where I think that the real growth has happened. And to the extent that you've seen this sort of massive buildup even within the Washington area, that really also is your sort of classic sort of big defense beltway contractors who, by the way, are on a buying spree, buying up all kinds of small cybersecurity companies. If you really want to start a startup today and have a high valuation or get gobbled up by a big company, start a cybersecurity company, start an antivirus company or a network defense company. I mean, it's extraordinary the rate at which they've been spreading, have been some of the biggest IPOs in the past few years, and many of them are getting gobbled up by these large defense contractors who are no longer building jet planes and missiles. They're doing cyber now.
What was the lesson of the Russian incursion into Ukraine in terms of the sort of cyber warfare?
Yeah, we saw some pretty quickly cyber components of that. With an interesting twist, there were soldiers, ground forces, who went into the actual physical cable stations where many of the hardware is located, and cut connections going into Crimea to try and sever communications off to the rest of the country. And there were cyber attacks launched against Ukrainian government websites to take them down. So that it made it more difficult for the government to communicate about what was happening. That was sort of a flavor of all of these kinds of battles and of the things to come, where you're going to see the cyber component take its place alongside the ground war, the air war, the naval war. And the U.S. military is, I think, getting very, has been very public about this and is being very clear-eyed about it. They know that our adversaries are building offensive cyber capabilities. We're going to do it as well. There are 5 dozen countries that are setting up some equivalent of the U.S. Cyber Command right now.
Yeah, Tom Ricks, who's a fellow here, has a famous and interesting question, which is, who would you prefer running the U.S. military of the 21st century, George Patton or Steve Jobs? What would your answer be to that?
I probably would still trust Patton more than Steve Jobs. I don't know. I mean, I come down at the end of the book, being deeply skeptical of the NSA, but, and this might seem kind of difficult to square, but being more strongly in favor of giving many of these cyber authorities over to the military and making it more of a clearly military operation. I think it's more accountable, even though the military is not a completely transparent organization. I think that intelligence agencies in this country, they are governed by a different section of the law. They engage in covert activities. I'm just much more comfortable if we're going to be fighting wars in cyberspace, I would rather be giving those authorities to the people who fight wars and make them more accountable.
And that raises sort of an interesting analogy with the whole question about drones, which are in both drones and cyber are you can have violent activities outside conventional war zones. And the question of who should control those and under which authorities, and do you want the CIA to control or the Pentagon? So you're saying it would be better if it was, it's more transparent if the Pentagon controls?
I think you get more transparency and accountability and arguably more doctrine kind of in rigor into the system.
But in practice, JSOC does much of this, so is that
true?
I mean, I don't think that's any more transparent necessarily.
Well, but this, I think what you're pointing to also is the way that these two worlds are fusing, right? And they're blurring. And you know, and JSOC is another piece of this of the story actually in Iraq in the beginning. The partner with NSA, those ground forces they were heading to, was JSOC. You know, this is you're seeing ways that the military and the intelligence kind of streams commingle now. I'm not sure that we'll ever be able to neatly pull them apart when we're talking about sort of small wars or even remote wars. What I would like to see, though, is to the extent that we are building up a national cyber force, which Chuck Hagel recently said he wants to see as many as 6,000 people by 2016, I would rather see that under some sort of more rigorous and at least more transparent combatant structure, the way we run all the rest of the military, and not see it drift into this sort of, you know, dark corner of special ops.
Speaking of Chuck Hagel, when he went to China, the New York Times reported that he, unsuccessfully it turned out, tried to explain to the Chinese what our red lines are.
Right.
What do you think our red lines are?
I think our red lines that they've been public about now are any attack on a critical infrastructure in the U.S., for one, that means the power grid, a major utility, the air traffic control system, an attack that brought down a bank or...
What would our response be?
Right now, the Pentagon's written policy on this is that an attack of that nature would merit a retaliatory response in cyberspace or kinetically. So, and I say this in the book, if China shut off the lights in San Francisco, and let's say for sake of argument that we could say pretty definitively we think it came from China, we would have bombers on the way to Beijing. We would view this as the opening salvo in some sort of larger war. And at the very least, we would see this as an attack that merited some kind of a response in kind.
Is the cyber Pearl Harbor plausible? That was a phrase that Leon Panetta used.
Yeah, I think he actually used it meaning something else. I think he meant a cyber 9/11, right? This sort of idea of a surprise attack that came out of nowhere. I think the idea of a cyber Pearl Harbor is plausible. And in fact, if there were a Chinese attack, let's say, on a piece of the power grid, which I think is a remote possibility, by the way, there's lots of reasons they have not to attack us in cyberspace domestically, we would see that as the beginning of something, not the end of it. We would assume that they were about to launch some sort of wider military campaign. Where I get more sort of worried about this and freaked out is a country like Iran, you know, which has been extremely aggressive and really quite reckless in the past 3 years of seeming to ignore any sense of what the lines are. Iran doing something potentially very devastating and not thinking through the next steps of how we would respond.
Well, speaking of Iran, if a country mounted a Stuxnet-like attack on us, would we consider it an act of war?
We probably would, yeah.
Do you think the Iranians considered the Stuxnet attack an act of war?
I think privately they probably did, yes. And I think even Iranians who I've talked to since the book has come out have said, if you ever thought about looking at this from our point of view, I mean, you attacked us. And in many ways, we did fire the first shot in the cyber war. And we sort of opened up the gates and gave them a reason to build a cyber army.
But isn't it instructive that at a certain point it was no longer deniable? I mean, there was an attribution. I mean, it was a German researcher just on his own, right, who basically worked it all out mostly, right? So the point is, if you do, it doesn't matter who the kind of protagonist is, there's going to be an attribution problem in the sense that the attribution will be made pretty definitively by somebody, right?
Eventually it will be, yeah.
So if the Chinese launch an attack on us, even through proxies or whatever this building, what's the number where they're housed, 3348 or whatever? I mean, we would attribute it very rapidly, probably.
Oh, I don't know how rapidly we would, but I think that we would find lots of ways to try and attribute it, and not just by trying to trace the signal. I mean, one of the things that the Defense Department does, and I write about this in the book, is it has a database of dossiers on known Chinese hackers, and it looks for signatures and kind of their trademark kind of imprint. There's lots of ways to try and attribute something. I think that you probably would also see if it were an attack, let's say, on a private institution, let's say it was on a bank, or let's say it was on a private utility, a company hiring its own people to come in and try and trace the source of that attack as well. And the FBI, of course, would be involved. But attribution is something that we always look for.
Okay, well, and so a private company is hacked, and there's a big issue about hacking back, mm-hmm. which is technically illegal here.
Yes, it is illegal.
But does it happen?
Yes. I talked to one former senior NSA official who said, and he wasn't going to name names, but he said, I know it's happening. I know it's illegal. And I think it's being handled for the most part by companies that are fairly scrupulous and careful.
Target, JP Morgan, I mean, who's hacking back? Do we have any sense?
I think that probably, I would be surprised if it was a company that large.
Yeah.
I would be more inclined, and I don't know for a fact, I don't want to mislead anyone, yeah. say I know who has been hacking back. It would not surprise me if it were companies in the defense space. I write in the book, though, that the companies that I worry most about retaliating actually are banks. So to the extent that banks are highly vulnerable and spend a lot of money on security, which they do, they have a lot to lose. It's our money, their money. I hypothesize that you might see one of the first cyber wars really break out by a bank deciding that it is sick of taking it in the shorts and the government's not coming to its rescue, so it's going to fire back at the Iranians who are coming for it. I think that's a distinct possibility. In fact, in 2012, there was a large, what's called denial of service attack directed at bank websites. This is not their data. It was their customer-facing websites that forced the websites to shut down, which sounds like an annoyance and an inconvenience, and it is, but it was also terrifying because the scale of this particular one was unlike anything that had been seen before. And when it was basically determined that this was coming from a nation state, some of these bank executives went to somebody in the Homeland Security Department who I interviewed for the book and said, what are you going to do about this? And he looked at them and said, we? What do you expect us to do? I mean, the banks were essentially saying, are you going to come to the rescue here? And the answer was no, not for an attack on a website. Now, if we were taking out the data in a bank or causing the NASDAQ to shut down, maybe. Hmm. But these companies realize that they're largely on their own here. And it's something I didn't appreciate when I started the research, is the extent to which the private cybersecurity industry is building up to offer these companies a way of protecting themselves that the government doesn't always readily have. If you're not a big critical infrastructure in the United States, responsible for running the internet and our critical systems, the government may not be, so interested in trying to protect and help you.
Throw it open to questions. If you have a question, can we just wait for the mic and identify yourself? So we start in the back and come to this.
Hi, thanks for coming. I just wondered if you could comment on the distribution of business that you're seeing going to large defense contractors as opposed to these startups like Endgame and VuPen for these sorts of services.
In terms of the dollar amounts, I couldn't tell you for sure. I think for companies like a VuPen, which is in this sort of the zero-day space to an extent, you're probably talking much smaller dollar amounts because big network defense programs that are the sort of the hundreds of millions and billion-dollar varieties are going to go to the bigger defense contractors, who then might hire a network of subcontractors to work on it. And you also have these companies too, in many cases, providing the cyber defense personnel for government networks. So those sort of contracts of human labor are going to be more expensive. But it definitely, I think, where the non-defense company sort of startups, like an Endgame or FireEye or these others, their revenue is going to be coming from the private sector, not so much the government.
How much people are paying for a zero-day vulnerability?
You can pay anywhere from a four- and five-figure sum up to, I was told by one person, if you found a vulnerability in an Apple iOS operating system, possibly a six-figure amount. There are companies that will sell subscription packages to these for seven figures a year over a period of time. So there's a lot of money in it. It's not a ton of money compared to, I guess, how you might find yourself if you were a private startup selling cybersecurity and surveillance services to lots of companies at once. It's a fairly niche market for 0 days, and in large measure it's propped up because the NSA is doing most of the buying, I think.
So one more question here. Yeah, just.
Hi, I'm Cliff Bob from the German Marshall Fund and Duquesne University. This is really interesting, and I haven't read the book, so I was just curious where in the end you really do come down on these issues. It sounded like you think that this whole cyber initiative as a military initiative is a mistake. You say it was counterproductive in your conclusion there. But I'm wondering also, in a broader sense, I didn't hear a lot about what the threat really is. I mean, lights being turned off in big cities, we've seen that numerous mm-hmm. times in the past, and the biggest consequence seems to be a bunch of babies born 9 months later. or, you know, even if you hit a couple of websites, or even a lot of websites, I'm not clear on, and maybe you said this earlier, but what is the real threat, and how, why isn't this just crime? Right. Why is it war? And what would a cyber war actually be? I mean, normally in a war, people actually die. This doesn't seem to go to that. So, and I guess the other aspect of this then is, you are referencing intelligence agencies and the military contractors saying how bad the threat is. Yet you're also talking about how, you know, previously it was terrorism and they're looking for a new mission and so forth. So I'm just not clear, and I'd be interested to hear where you come out on whether this truly is a real threat and whether it is, if that, you know, a criminal or military sort of thing.
Sure. Well, a lot of the threat is definitely crime. I mean, it's, you know, we see this in credit card data being stolen from, you know, in the hundreds of millions from Home Depot, Target. Companies having bank accounts emptied, you know, this is something that the FBI deals with a lot. We don't see this on the individual consumer level as much. There's a criminal element that I think is not without cost, obviously. Something I write a lot about in the book is cyber espionage. So China is largely responsible for stealing billions of dollars worth of intellectual property from American businesses, taking information and giving it to their Chinese competitors. I think there's a real cost associated with that. The sort of the dire nightmare scenarios, right, where you would cross over, I think, into the realm of warfare and events that would trigger some kind of collective national response from the military, do fall into this realm of critical infrastructure attacks. So not just shutting off the lights, but possibly causing physical equipment like generators to break down, to stop functioning, and it could take possibly 2 to 3 to 4 months to replace them. So you're talking about the possibility of extended blackouts, sections of whole cities without power for a very long time, the ability to open up water treatment facilities and contaminate large amounts of water serving hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people. One story I read about in the bank that actually the director of national intelligence, or in the book, sorry, told to President Bush in a meeting in 2007 was, imagine if the hackers on 9/11, instead of flying planes into buildings, or the attackers, sorry, had been computer hackers who broke into the systems of a major U.S. bank and either deleted account information or corrupted it in such a way that no transactions could no longer be processed. The bank would have to close and it would ignite a financial panic, essentially, in the banking sector that would then ripple out. This is something that these are what you would call very high impact, low probability scenarios, but nevertheless are the ones that are keeping people up at night and that are sort of animating our response to cyber threats. I don't think that those are particularly likely. I think the Chinese, for instance, have a great incentive not to attack our banks. They're our largest lender. Why would they do something like that? But the barrier to entry in this space is a lot lower than fielding a traditional military. It's a lot easier to build the capacity to launch a devastating attack like this than it is to build a long-range bomber that you could send towards us. So I think that the threat to some degree has been hyped by national security officials, but it is not outside the realm of possibility, these kinds of sort of full-scale.
Well, tell the audience about the Syrian Electronic Army and what they did to the effects they had on the Dow. They put out, didn't the Syrian Electronic Army get into an AP Twitter feed and say there was an attack on the White House?
That's right. Yeah, so this is a sort of an information propaganda operation. So they hacked the Twitter feed, said there was an attack of the AP, said there was an attack on the White House. I think they maybe have said that the president had been killed. And there was this sort of, you know, 5-minute freak out where everyone on Twitter and social media thought that the president had been killed. And you did see a dip, I think, in the Dow Industrial Average. It sort of, you know, was at this momentary kind of pulse. An event like that is one that people in the national security community will point to and say, look, these are ways that you can cause, you know, real consequences, kinetic consequences, short-lived perhaps, recoverable. But what they do is they point to, well, what about, you know, what happens when there's the blackout that does last for 3 months and not for 3 hours? And again, I mean, I'm very critical and skeptical of a lot of officials in the book coming out and saying, including like Leon Panetta, and telling people, you know, we're one moment away from devastation. The National Security Agency director just said this, you know, a couple of weeks ago in testimony. I think we need to be skeptical of that and manage the problem, you know, commensurately and not lose our heads about this. But there's no doubt that information is being stolen, privacy is being violated, you know, financial fraud and crime are being perpetrated. Bad things are happening, and it merits some kind of a response. And where I ultimately come down on it is in wanting to see our response be measured and judicious and not fundamentally undermine the security of the internet. Where I really am most critical is that when the NSA is in the mode of we're in charge of leading the cyber war and the offensive mission, they are inevitably going to be finding ways to weaken all of the technology that we depend upon. That mission is at conflict with its, with a defensive mission. I think you need to separate ultimately.
So what do you make of James Comey's kind of, you know, extended public criticism of, I guess, both Google and Apple for making phones with, you know, that are encrypted in such a way that neither Google or Apple will be able to access them, yeah, even if the government demands it?
I think that is a proxy for a much larger fight and a bit of a smokescreen, frankly, although I respect Jim Comey a lot, that the FBI is waging for the better part of the past 20 years. Really, ever since the advent of the internet, the FBI became very concerned that it would no longer be able to monitor communications and do surveillance in cyberspace.
They call it going dark.
Going dark, and this is not the first time that they've said that this could happen. The same thing happened in the mid-90s when during something called the crypto wars, when commercial encryption became available for the first time, and the FBI said it's going to be adopted by terrorists and drug dealers, and we'll never be able to spy and wiretap on anyone again, and we won't be able to prosecute crimes. Well, it didn't really happen. We fashioned a law that requires the telecommunications networks, the phones networks in this country, to be built in such a way that the FBI and law enforcement, when they have a warrant, can tap into them to make sure that they can technically get the information that they need to get. That law was not extended to the internet when it was passed about 20 years ago. And ever since then, the FBI has been looking for a way back into that. And I think that what Comey is doing is throwing out Apple and the iPhone and encryption as a way of starting this conversation back up again. Tellingly, he talked about this most extensively about a month and a half ago at Brookings, and somebody asked him, they said, well, what's your larger legislative plan? Where's the bill that you're proposing? And he said, well, we don't really have one, and I'm kind of leaving that to experts. So you can see Comey, I think, kind of trying to kind of light a fire here and using this device as sort of the convenient jumping off point. What the FBI is really about is extending surveillance law to the internet and to technology.
Just so we understand his argument, I mean, it's not as crazy as, or as, you know, I mean, he's sort of like, you know, if you're trying to, let's say, prosecute a child pornographer who's sure. been exchanging images through a phone, and there's just simply no way to access the data, well, how do you make the case? I mean, I guess that's the kind of argument he's making. And what's your response to that?
Well, there are lots of other ways to get the data. I mean, if you're really talking about somebody who is not using the cloud, who was not emailing the information to another computer, that it was literally only on this device, then yes, then you might have a problem in that. But there are lots of ways to get that information. I think you have to ask the question, you know, is it worth, you know, changing our laws and extending surveillance more to the sector as a whole just to be able to get it in the rare cases on this phone? There are plenty of ways to get the information, and Comey knows that too.
New America did research on the issue of how much companies like Google and others lost, you know, and it's in the billions and billions of dollars, right, in terms of people around the world saying, well, wait a minute.
Because of the Snowden revelations, right. I mean, there's, I say this in the book too, that there's a perception, I think, that, you know, in foreign countries, that American technology, kind of once viewed as a gold standard, now has this, you know, is synonymous with government spying. Mm-hmm. And to the extent that people think that our corporations are just handing over information on foreigners and foreign targets, why would you want to do business with an American tech company?
80% of email traffic around the world transits the United States, right?
About,
I mean, do you think, do you see that number going down? Do you see, I mean, I think the Germans in particular are obviously very concerned about privacy issues. I mean, how would they sort of make that number go down if they could? I mean, they seem to want to.
Yeah. They have talked about, Germans particularly, and I think this has come up in Venice or Brazil as well, the idea of trying to require companies like Facebook to locate all of, you know, German citizens' data on servers in Germany. And this kind of notion of trying to sort of balkanize the internet, whereby Germany would say, okay, for most purposes of Germans' activity on the internet will be kind of contained within networks that are in Germany. I actually interviewed, not related to the book, but Eric Schmidt about this from Google about a year ago and asked him about this question. And, you know, and what his response was, you know, we couldn't possibly make, you know, a Germany Google, a Belgium Google, an Italy Google. The internet doesn't work that way. Well, you might get close to it, though. And I think that, you know, companies can do, countries can do things to require that, you know, what Ted Stevens said, this is a series of tubes, after all. This is equipment that we're talking about here on some degree of trying to physically put that in one place. I don't know that you ever would get to this completely segregated geographic kind of internet. But there are plenty of things that companies can do. Look at the right to be forgotten legislation in Europe.
Do the Chinese have something that is sort of closer to that, where they have a sort of internal?
Yeah, I mean, they're sort of with the Great Firewall of China, where you have much more controls inside China on the ability to access the internet, the public internet from in China, and to get past its censors. But, you know, people can do that. There are plenty of ways around that. Maybe in China you have some case studies there of ways that you could kind of, you know, wall off your country. But there you figure it's being done for, you know, for state control and limitation of freedom of speech. We're sort of, you know, in the German context, you're sort of like trying to protect us from the NSA. So, but the technology is agnostic in that regard.
Go ahead. Go
ahead. Robert Schroeder with International Investor. Sometimes we look at these issues less at an institutional level, more at a human level. And I wonder if you would comment on that. I think in 2013, it was estimated that 25 of our major weapons systems had been compromised in one way or another. I didn't see any charges leveled against any individuals, either in the military or the defense contractors, that may have been responsible for that. Our cynical approach is that there's a lot of money involved. These are hundreds of billions of dollars of R&D. Individuals can quickly enrich themselves by allowing a vulnerability to take place. Have you looked into that at all? I haven't read your book yet, but I wonder if you might comment on that.
Yeah. On the question of whether allowing it to happen, I have not looked at that. So, I mean, I guess, are you suggesting like a company would like be betting against itself, or kind of gaming the system and betting against the known vulnerability? I mean, I'm sure there are probably smart hackers out there who are also playing the market, betting on when, you know, where the next, you know, breach might occur. I did not look at that specifically. But one thing your question makes me think about is whether or not corporations have a fiduciary responsibility to protect their networks. So when Target is breached and, you know, more than 100 million, I think, of its customers' financial data is stolen, should Target be held accountable to some degree to that and be responsible to its shareholders? Right now, under the law, I don't think it allows for that. I'm not, maybe somebody wanted to, you know, an eager lawyer would want to
in the
use
court of public
law
opinion,
to test that.
They certainly suffered.
I think it does. I think it suffers in public opinion. I think you're going to see banks and retailers starting to advertise good cybersecurity as a selling point.
And there's a huge incentive, by the way, for these companies to say nothing when they do get hacked, right?
Yeah, and for a long time, that was the MO, was to say nothing. Who actually broke the dam on that was Google. In 2010, coming public and saying that they'd been hacked by China and that their intellectual property had been stolen. And then companies kind of felt more likely to come and say it. But
if you're a bank, I mean, J.P. Morgan, obviously, did they release that information themselves, or how did that information?
I don't know if J.P. Morgan released that voluntarily or not, but once it came out, they did not shy away from talking about it. Yeah. And that event scared a lot of people, too, because banks are supposed to have the best security. And what I think that points to as well is there's we have to be careful that we don't get into the mode of blaming the victim, right? I mean, so J.P. Morgan is not casual about cybersecurity. It spends $250 million a year on it. Banks are very, very good at this in the sector. If J.P. Morgan can be hit, it gives you a real insight into the sophistication and the aggressiveness and the persistence of the attacker. So to some extent, I mean, we don't blame the homeowner when the burglar finds a way into the house, right? So we have to get that balance right. But companies who are doing nothing, I mean, I think Home Depot was widely criticized for not having taken security seriously enough at all. I mean, maybe there's a threshold by which you have to demonstrate you are doing some minimum of good security to be responsible. But
does every big company now have a chief information officer?
Not every one, but I mean, it's growing. I mean, you're seeing the chief security officer, information security officer, becoming the place that's really where it's taking off. And, you know, and you're seeing a lot of people who are coming from the military and the intelligence community in that. I mean, you gain a lot of expertise and skills about good defense working in government.
Gentleman here.
Dan Thompson with State Department, but here in my free time. if I get on a jumbo jet from Dulles and fly to San Francisco on 700 pounds of jet fuel, metal, and human lives, it's highly regulated. Every step of the way is highly regulated. Right. We keep hearing that the internet is key to the United States national interests. So why isn't it more regulated? And why is this such a permissive environment? Why are we asking companies to improve practices? And going back to the AP hack with the Syrian Electronic Army, which I think cost us $60 billion on paper over 5 minutes in the Dow. Like, why even build an aircraft carrier if you can do that to another country? It makes no sense. Just hack the Twitter feed. Right. Why don't we see a move towards that? And thinking of this in the traditional kinetic war frame of mind, you know, we're waiting for a cyber Pearl Harbor. But if you look at the cumulative effects of all these attacks, like Target and all the countless others, it is a Pearl Harbor that's happened cumulatively. And it's happening right now, you know, millions of times a nanosecond that we're getting hacked. So it is already happening. This Pearl Harbor it's here. And then the only other question I have, other than why it's not heavily regulated, is who's watching Google? Because human behavioral data, human behavioral information has become a highly valuable mass-produced commodity. And I think that that could have consequences for discriminating against consumers and have very broad social consequences, I think even more than
that is a really interesting question. And I want to add to that, which is like, there was an interesting piece in the journal about people looking at big data and that they can tell, you know, with like extraordinary high levels of probability what your sexual preferences are, you know.
If you're pregnant.
Right. Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, it's a form of that question. So,
yeah. I think we need to have, and there are bills that have been proposed in Congress about this, much stronger consumer data protection laws. I mean, we have a whole suite of laws that govern what the government can do with your data and how they can access it, and comparatively nothing when it comes to private information. And particularly if companies like Google are using information even in a macro sense about their customers and then sharing that with the National Security Agency. You know, there's a lot of mingling going on here, and I think we need to have better control of that. To your question about why isn't it more regulated, I mean, there have been sort of, there's broadly speaking, this kind of dueling philosophies about that question. And there have been a number of cybersecurity bills that have been put forth over the years that have some degree of either regulation or something that looks like regulation, where the government is going to say, okay, this is the minimum standard that either companies or critical infrastructure companies, vital ones, have to meet the following standards. And it has always gone down in defeat, largely, you know, to be frank, thanks to the business community. They don't, you know, and the Chamber of Commerce has opposed this. They don't want to see a lot of heavy regulation. There are privacy concerns as well associated with some of this. But basically, business has resisted it. And Obama, in that speech that he gave, there's an interesting evolution, I think, that is just, I'm just starting to appreciate. In that East Room speech that he gave in 2009, where he talked about it being a strategic national asset and protecting the internet, he also said, we are not going to force companies. We're not going to dictate to companies how they do their security. It's going to be cooperative, which is to say we're not going to regulate them directly in that way. But about 3 weeks ago, he gave in his weekly address his comments on net neutrality. And he talked about his preference of wanting to see the internet treated like more like a utility within the context of net neutrality. But if you start calling the internet a utility, then absolutely you can regulate it. Governments regulate utilities. I mean, that's what we do. And it's something that I think that not a lot of people sort of picked up on this idea. I'm not even sure whether he meant to go there, but he kind of went there a little bit. And he at least flicked at that possibility. I think that ultimately what's going to happen is there's going to be some catastrophic level or near to that attack that really gets people's attention. I mean, stealing credit card information and data, it's an inconvenience. The bank's going to replace your credit card. You know, if tomorrow 100,000 Wells Fargo customers wake up and their bank accounts, their checking accounts have been erased, that's going to be different. And that's going to open up a conversation about regulation.
Jamaica? Okay, we're just, okay.
I'm curious about your views on whether or not this affects the policy content, foreign policy content. For example, when you casually threw out, oh, well, we did Stuxnet, and so they're mad. And then you cited that as one of Iran being one of the major things. So what I find, other than the policies themselves somewhat incoherent, is how do you get accountability? Who decided to do that to Iran?
Yeah.
And now we sit here.
Right.
The accountability and the
Yeah. Well, right now, I mean, who decides to do it is the president. So Stuxnet is was a presidentially authorized covert intelligence program. Right now, I hesitate to say doctrine because that makes it sound more formal in the military than it actually is. But under existing executive orders, if the United States were to launch a cyber attack, let's say on another country's systems or something like that, it requires the president signing off on it. They're treated as strategic weapons, sort of in the same way that we treat nuclear weapons, where the president has to be involved. Now, there are ways of kind of putting that authority down the chain a bit. So like if we're in Iraq, for instance, President Bush authorized those operations that were conducted in Iraq, but he did not have to then go authorize every single one. He said, you know, the NSA is authorized to do the following things when it comes to communications, gathering, and cyber activities. So there is a level of accountability right up to the level of the commander-in-chief. I think as cyber activity becomes more pervasive, you can't have the president signing off on every single, you know, one of these attacks any more than he signs off on every time someone fires, you know, a rifle. But I do think it's going to largely be governed in that context of, you know, the commander-in-chief, his authorities, both, you know, to authorize intelligence operations and military operations. So for the foreseeable future, at least at the very top, it'll be the president authorizing these things. That's where the accountability will be.
To Micah.
And for the foreign policy blowback for that as well, I should add. Yeah.
Well, first, Shane, congratulations. This is great reporting and extremely impressive. I'm a newly minted senior fellow here at New America, but prior to that, in a past life, I was speechwriter to Secretary Clinton and wrote her first speech on internet freedom. And in conjunction with that was also the victim of an unrelenting stream of spear phishing attacks that continue up to and including this morning from people trying to get into my account. And I'm sure you and many others have had the ominous pink banner show up on your Gmail account that foreign hackers are trying to gain access to your account. Given the two sides of that, you know, experience, the incredible power of these tools to serve the purposes of progress and good, and also the real dangers that we face when using them, at what point do we need to pause and let our regulatory structures catch up with the technologies? Mm-hmm. You mentioned the difficulty that you had seen in trying to bifurcate the command structures and the fact that it would upset the apple cart, and so we can't do anything on it right now. At what point is there a need to kind of sit back, hopefully prior to some sort of cataclysmic event, and figure out where we need to put these authorities to get it right?
I think we're there, honestly. I mean, and I think that I find it difficult, the argument difficult to swallow that we shouldn't be to some degree regulating security when the fact is that we regulate food safety. You know, we regulate utility companies. We regulate electrical power facilities. Why wouldn't we regulate their network security the same way we regulate, you know, their physical security or their, you know, the making sure that they have the right equipment so that they don't fry their circuits? I mean, it just seems to me that the idea that you couldn't just naturally then extend that one more layer onto the security of a network, that just makes no sense to me. And we should be doing that now because, as you point out, you know, the threat's there. It's not like we need any more evidence that these systems are at risk. Why would we wait for the cataclysmic event? Except politically, that's how it always works, right? We need that to sort of shake us loose of this.
But the counter-argument with Target, didn't they go in through the air conditioning system?
Yeah, they went through a subcontractor,
so,
exactly.
So, like, I mean, it's hard to defend everything, right?
Yeah, you'll never defend everything. But, I mean, you know, why not start with the companies that are already regulated?
Yeah.
Right? I mean, like, why? And, you know, and a lot of electric companies have, I think there was actually an electric CEO who testified about this, saying, we are a regulated industry, right? So, I mean, you know, there is a natural kind of opening, at least there to start, it seems to me, with some of your more vital systems. And, you know, I think just politically, the administration hasn't been inclined to do it. There's been a real lobbying against it. But, yeah, I mean, I think we're there right now.
Lady in back.
Thank you, Gigi Alford. I work at Freedom House. I found your argument very interesting at the end that it may make more sense to shift some of the more cyber aggression in the U.S. from the NSA to the military. And you mentioned the military calling the internet the fifth dimension or domain of warfare. Mm-hmm. Do you see any possibility that there could be a way to normalize thinking about who are civilians and who are combatants on the internet. Because at some point, we have international norms around the law of armed conflict or international humanitarian law. But on the internet, you know, how are we able to declare ourselves civilians or non-combatants and therefore off limits to some of that aggression?
I think it's a great question, and it's something that, you know, national security lawyers have been talking about, you know, to some degree already. I do think that you can apply international humanitarian law or law of armed conflict to cyber conflicts. I mean, we could just say as a matter of principle that we are only going to launch attacks against legitimate command and control targets. You know, the same way that we agree to only bomb certain facilities. We could, when the president wants to order an attack, I mean, could say, look, what is the risk of collateral damage going to be? In fact, in 2003, prior to the invasion of Iraq, there was a proposal on the table to launch a cyber attack against the financial networks in Iraq to try and basically freeze up Saddam's money and, you know, one way of sort of hamstringing the country. And it was ruled out because we couldn't guarantee that whatever virus we launched against that network wouldn't spread and possibly end up in banking systems in Europe. So, you know, shutting off ATM access in Paris or something. So, I mean, we have a framework for being able to conceive of what collateral damage might be. It might be a heck of a lot harder to predict because of the nature of these weapons that can sort of get into a network and then propagate and get out of control. But I don't think that we should just, you know, dismiss out of hand the idea that IHL can be applied to cyber conflict. I mean, it's not maybe a neat one for one, but you can fashion it in a way.
But you could imagine a kind of new Geneva convention that would, you know, because a lot of the same issues are true for drones as well. I mean, where you kind of have we're in a slightly new space where the kind of blend, I mean, the distinction between civilian and, I mean, if a civilian contractor is launching a military attack, or whether it's drone or cyber, I mean, that kind of raises interesting questions about the lady raised. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I think it's time for us to have a collective discussion because I think what the analogy is also sort of where we lost the monopoly on atomic weaponry. Mm-hmm. It became in our interest to have a international regime around the control of this weaponry once we lost the monopoly. And we're really there with drones. I mean, Russia, China, Iran all have armed drones. Whatever the regime is, we have to be comfortable that we feel good about the Iranians adhering to that regime as well. And I think the same is true with cyber. So I think there is we've come to the moment where we should be starting to have that discussion.
Yeah.
Because IHL, international humanitarian law, you know, yes, can be applied, but is it sufficient? Because it didn't conceive of any of these weapons,
mm-hmm. A treaty is something that's been discussed, and you know, DeMica, you probably can speak to this too. I mean, it's you know, the Russians aren't necessarily all that eager to get into a treaty with us. Although that's been discussed, I mean, how do you verify that somebody is not stockpiling cyber weapons, et cetera? You know, I thought that, you know, and Hegel deserves credit for this, I mean, the going to China and saying, let's talk about mutual red lines, that's a good sort of first start in this. Of course, the Chinese said, we'll listen to you, and then they told us nothing. So, I mean, I think for a lot of countries, they have a very powerful incentive not to engage in treaties with us because we have a more powerful conventional military, and this is the way they can gain advantage over us. And why would they ever want to, you know, to preemptively limit their use of it? On the other hand, you know, if we get into the, you know, a sort of mutually assured destruction kind of mindset, which might be helpful, and we make very clear to the Chinese, like, look, if you ever did something like this, like, it's over with us, you know, that might lead bigger powers into some sort of more of a
there would also be a
discussion.
Political problem probably in Washington, because on the right it would be this kind of discussion would be criticized for constraining American power, and on the left it would be kind of criticized for acknowledging that these things really exist and we need to be serious about them, right? So right. It would be a tough. In the back, gentlemen.
Thank you. Hi, Jonathan Daigle from JD Solutions. I really enjoyed this dialogue. This is very interesting. I'm really looking forward to your book. I agree completely with this idea that the NSA can't both protect cyber networks but also be in charge of getting at them. And so this idea of regulation, the merging of military networks, warfare, I mean, I think this, first of all, I thought this was a great discussion until the idea that we're going to regulate security. I'd like to know how you think we're possibly going to have regulation that is going to enhance our security as the technology changes so quickly that those regulations become irrelevant. Mm-hmm. And secondly, you know, I've spent 25 years in the Department of Defense, and the idea that we can have international treaties that are going to keep people from doing cyber conflict, that doesn't bother Al-Qaeda, doesn't bother the Syrian factions. Those things are not going to keep us safe. So we're just faced with so many dichotomies or contradictions in this whole thing. You know, how can we approach wrapping this up in a way that we do not have to wait for, you know, a situation where there's loss of life or extreme loss of property? You know, do you have any way ahead, having done all this research?
You just solve all the world's problems.
Right. Well, one way, I mean, you know, look, I mean, this is, and you very rightly point out, you know, that regulation is going to be, you know, probably hopelessly outdated the moment that you propose it. The administration went through a long process recently with the National Institute of Standards and Technology, or NIST, coming out with a recommendation for kind of best practices that people should adopt. They're probably outmoded already. I wonder, and I'm just speculating here, but I mean, whether or not, rather than by saying, you know, meet these minimum standards, whether it was something more like you are required to employ people with X level of competency in doing cybersecurity, right? I'm sure companies like FireEye and Mandiant would love that. You know, yeah, go out and hire us. But having some kind of, you know, sophisticated people in place that can keep up with the threats, because this is the nature of cyber defense, right? Is the bad guys keep getting better and better and better, and the defenses keep getting outmoded all the time. So no, it can't just be like the way it would be with food safety or something like this. So you would have to have some level of assurance that people were on the job, that were doing more than just checking boxes. I mean, we have a problem with this in government. There's something called FISMA, the Federal Information Security Management Act, which requires government agencies every year to, you know, check the box that they've done the following things and the following safety protocols and all that. And everybody regards it as a joke, and nobody thinks it's actually protecting networks. Well, the reason that, you know, the Defense Department and the NSA are so good at protecting their networks is they employ really smart people that are constantly keeping pace with the threat and evolving against it. And I think if there's a way forward, ultimately, it's probably going to be by a whole new business and a sector of the economy developing around this. I mean, I really think you're going to have cybersecurity companies doing cybersecurity for most companies in the United States, and that the government is going to probably focus on the much more kind of critical aspects of the economy. That, to me, that would be a smart way forward. I mean, the NSA has been in the mode for a number of years of sort of trying to do it all, and they need to kind of come back down to earth a bit. On that, and I think this is there's going to be a market is going to emerge in some way to address a lot of these problems.
The gentleman raises a point, though, which I think may be wrong, at least for now, which is, you know, treaties obviously won't constrain Al-Qaeda. I mean, Al-Qaeda is not constrainable, but their capacity to do something that would really damage our national security, I think, is close to zero. Mm-hmm. And I, you know, the Syrian Electronic Army, yeah, they did this thing, but I mean, it was essentially a nuisance. So, I mean, the kinds of things that you're concerned about are mounted by states, and the number of states that can do this are relatively big states. I mean, Iran, China, Russia, ourselves. It's not Israel. I mean, we're not talking about a huge group. So the idea that you might have some kind of international treaty where there would be, like, some kind of laws of, you know, that there would be some kind of understanding that where the red lines are collectively, I think is I don't think that's a crazy idea.
I don't think it's crazy, and it could cover, you know, it could give us some layers of security. And you raised the interesting question about, you know, Al-Qaeda and, you know, terrorist groups being able to mount these kinds of attacks. And after 9/11, there was a real fear of, you know, cyber terrorism, and you still kind of hear it as a, you know, a bit of a buzzword. But the general, I think, assumption is that you're right, is that Al-Qaeda has been much more focused on spectacular physical attacks. They don't have the expertise. Where I worry is, you know, it only takes one or two people making the decision to change the strategy. So, you know, take somebody like, you know, an Ibrahim al-Assiri, who is this master bomb maker.
Okay, so he changes through the thought experiment.
But they go out and hire someone to do it for them. That's
okay.
What I worry about.
All right, like, who would they hire? I mean, because, I mean, it, you know, obviously a Stuxnet-like attack was a highly sophisticated, involved two very strong players in the field, both the United States and Israel. So, I mean, sketch out where a terrorist group sort of hired some hacker. What could that hacker really do?
I mean, I think that if you, and this is going to start to sound like a Bond movie a little bit.
Okay.
But I mean, you know.
It's a good way to sort of wrap things up.
Yeah, yeah. Find some, you know, a deeply unethical, malicious, you know, Eastern European, probably. sorry. you know, a group of individuals who basically are, you know, a highly sophisticated criminal enterprise who say, yeah, we'll do a power blackout for you. Sure. I mean, I think that's possible. Absolutely. And, you know, and if Al-Qaeda really decided that that's where they wanted to marshal their resources, sure. And, you know, look, ISIS gets a lot of credit for being very technologically savvy in their use of social media, and those two things are not the same thing, obviously. But they're sort of, you're getting closer to this idea of why wouldn't somebody in ISIS be like, you know what, we should look into this idea of hiring somebody in Belarus to do this. Why not? I bet we could pay them enough money to do it.
You know? Well, on that cheerful note, Shane is going to be more than happy to sign books.
Yes.
And let's give him a round of applause.
Thank you.